Cindy gave me a very beautiful drawing and quotation from Cheyenne Indians on his marriage in the North and the marriage in the South, and then the East and the West concepts that are really very, very moving. There's no way for me to paraphrase them because it's so beautifully done itself. Now, bring that out at the interim. Other people might like to read it. But in the marriage of the South, there is a marriage with, it's a different kind of marriage, a marriage with a sister. My grandson was on his 18th birthday. My granddaughter, who's a year older, I went into his room and his birthday, and she had on, she'd done little things on the wall, made a little drawing, but she'd written these words. So many love you, as do I. Who do I thank on this day of your birth that you were born a part of me, that you were born my brother? I really felt quite that kind of a feeling, because I do find it. I watched these two young people doing much skirmishing and kind of battling when they were young, but the sense of a brother and sister and love of those two is a very, very beautiful thing to me. They seem to have grown up to it. There's no question about a love that's not a physical baby making love that goes on between human beings. I feel this very strongly with my fellow men, fellow humans. This first question, what do you say about coordinating the vibrations of music with those of light with the object of causing a healing effect in a person with disease, dis-ease? For instance, music used to change mood, sounds to destroy, color to affect mood, combine all to affect healing, maybe in conjunction with acupuncture, points under pyramids, domes. I'm just going to say something technical about music, because this brings it up. You may remember that Pythagoras also discovered that we take a tensed string, because we're dealing in tension compression, and I think about the 10 seconds. If you have the length of a tensed string, you go up one octave. But octaves are related to halvings of unity. This is, again, like quantum. You start with a whole, and you fractionate the whole. And then that makes the octaves. Then to discover that when you third the strings, you get the fifths, which give us then our keys going up in the sharps and flats, all on those are fifths, but they're brought about by thirding the string, and halving it makes the octaves. That's really very, very fascinating, fundamental. And when we get to such, I don't like my use of the word fundamental. I'm a conditioned reflex. They're words that I have to try to get out, and I don't like fundamental because I don't think there really are any foundations. Somebody asked me another question here about my use of the, I found I've been using the word package, and I think the word package is not quite as bad as a particle, but it is the same kind of a word. It's a thing word, and I don't think things. I think verbs and events, and so that I keep house cleaning my language. Even the word house is a bad one. So. excuse me from time to time if in my spontaneous discourse I revert to the use of words that I would not use on writing in paper, but I'll catch myself on paper that's coming out. I'll often use the ones that I do not approve of. Now, coming back to the music, I want to have a feeling that when you get to something as absolutely simple as just having, that it makes octaves. This must be something very deep in all of us that we don't know about, and if Pythagoras happens to discover it so, which is very, very fascinating. There's a great deal written about what I'm talking about, and the man that I've dedicated my book Synergetics to, Coxeter, who I think is the greatest geometer of our time, has written some very important discourses on Pythagoras' work and the relation and getting into harmonics so fast. Just a number goes, some simple things which could be of interest to all of you. Now, in relation to what this music might do to people in various ways, and correlating the word music with light, I became fascinated with this subject at the time of the first Dymaxion House, where I was trying to really develop a generalized, be as generalized as I could, and then reduce it to special case advantage for life, and particularly the new life. And I determined to have everything that I had of a physical nature as close to possible to neutral, so that, like the piano, which would be muted until you began to play it. I thought of it as a musical instrument. And the architecture, that is, whatever you might get out in harmonic, would have to be something the way you used your house. So I tried to have colors at neutral and arranged, as I showed you, where there was a control where the light coming from the center of the house could come any color. I could make rooms different colors, but simply by introducing colored light. And that I tried to have the room as nearly neutral as possible. I went through just concepts of fog and the neutrality of fog, so forth. But fog isn't really quite that way, and I found that aluminum colors and just grays were not as neutral as so. I found that the human eye really has things it's accustomed to. It is really accustomed to a brown earth, and this has the most neutral effect, apparently, more so than if I tried to make a green floor or a black floor, white floor. The earth color seemed to be just very, very, very excellent. So the point was, I sought for the neutral tone, if I could find it, but tried to arrange for humanity then to change things. Then I found that at the time I was doing the Dymaxion House, Wilfrid was working on a color organ for the first time. And this is back in the 20s, and a very interesting man. And I found that it did not please me, and people were fascinated, but they didn't seem to use the word. They were not being particularly satisfied. They were interested or fascinated. I came to the conclusion that in relation to what I gave you the other day about sensing, and the distances that you can sense, and that these are very different magnitudes. And I found then that in nature, as far as color goes, nature changes colors really quite rapidly from day to night. She gives you blue skies, the clouds change, really goes up. And we get immersed in a gray day, and we feel gray. We don't get the... Very hard for us to tell that the mood we're in the gray day isn't the same mood we're in a blue day, but blue clear sky day, because we don't move from one to the other fast enough. Yet, yet the colors do change fairly rapidly, get up to lightning. The season colors change quite slowly. So we have the day and night, but day and night takes quite a lot of hours. And if the sky is clouding over, that takes quite a long time. Begin to take actually how long the scene is in and comes out. They're pretty large. They're not in seconds, and they're not, they tend to be in hours. And then the season colors change, the snows and the green periods, so, well, those are quite slow. But then I found the sounds seem to change really quite rapidly. There are rushings of brooks and the birds' notes. The frequency of sound change is very much more rapid than the frequency of the light change. That we're accustomed to it that way. And so that we can take very high beats in music and so forth. But if you get that in light, it goes beyond a certain periodicity, it gets to be startling and shocking. And we do not freeze on very rapidly. We can, if it's a shaped picture. There's been, of course, a great deal been done with computerization of moving pictures and doing producing some very fascinating things that are the word fascinating, but I think they have to be designed. They have to have some transformational continuity. They have to be comprehensible, not to be shocking. Then I find smells. We have really Lily of the Valley periods go for several weeks, and then we have rose periods. These smells can continue for quite a long time. Those notes do not change rapidly. If they would change too rapidly, they get to be confusing, not particularly pleasing. Touch. The kind of periodicity we get, the roughness and smoothness and sense of it is fairly difficult to say what the periodicity is, but we're terribly sensitive to the change with our touch between the rough and the smooth, whatever it may be, if you're just finding a way that way. But I think these harmonics are really they're quite different scales. I don't think so far anything that I have experienced of human beings trying to bring together the light and the sound are very successful, just as light and sound notes abstracted. If you're seeing a picture, something you recognize as a total synergetic affair, it is life, and you see the scene is changing with some, you're going to handle that kind of complexity very well, but as it really is being handled as a whole. I don't know whether I'm being very good in my answering of the question. What can you say about coordinating the vibrations of music with those of light, the object of causing a healing effect in a person with disease? I have no experimental knowledge of this. I can certainly accredit that it could be so. It seems to me, sounds, so it might be, but particularly if the person is particularly musical. I would think this might be very, very powerful. But using sounds to destroy, yes, we do get particularly ultrasonics, and we can do some very shattering things with vibration, no question about that. And then I'll guess about the harmonics again, where you could break a, smash a bridge. Then you get to asking about points on the pyramids. One of the things we have a great deal about in synergetics that Sonny Applewhite and I have talked about a great deal relates to the, I mentioned to you, if you had a triangle, light can bounce around in the triangle, or it can go out through the edge of the triangle, but when there's an impingement on an edge of a triangle, the line goes through and you find the great circle comes out the same angle between the two lines on this side and that side. Some of you learned in geometry long ago. So you can either have the line go out of the triangle or it'll bounce back in at the same angle. And so the energies can stay inside the triangle or they can come out of the triangle into the next one. And that's really what I was showing you with folding up great circles. Where this great circle then came together again and reestablished the great circle went on, where it could be, the folding was simply the way the energies or the sounds would be, would be locally shunted into local holding patterns or it could go on in the great circle. Do you understand that? This is, I find it very fascinating matter. So when we got into the A and B components out of which you made all the geometries, then I found that the fact that the A could be made out of one triangle, therefore the energy would stay in an A, but the B could not be made out of one triangle. Therefore the energies would not stay in the B. B is an energy loser and an A is an energy holder. And these, when we get then to the proton and neutrons and to just the nucleon idea, we get to where one is really neutral and also has great similarity here in principle to that idea of the sphere becoming a space, the space becoming a sphere. There's an enormous number of interchangeabilities here, but the angle refraction business, and this brings me back then to the business about pyramids. And you can trace in the B particle how the energies then, well, you'll find that they come out of the triangle, but they work towards the end and come out of the end. You just follow the bounce pattern, it goes out. And so I could see with the pyramids, which are half octahedra, and they have both the A's and the B's, and they're the heart of the octahedra. Octahedron. You remember that I had the B's are superimposed on the A's. Do you remember that? How you first found them? And thinking about then those the mites and the mites and the sites where I had these asymmetrical tetrahedra, but they were also right angle isosceles asymmetric, and they filled all the space. That you have then the B and the B, two B's and then one A. Those B's are energy diffusers, and the A is an energy holder. But you'd be at the center there. I could see then where there could be some very interesting effects in half octahedra of energy as far as pyramids go. I can really explain and can show the mathematics of it all right. I often have young people talk to me about this half pyramid business and about satiated razor blades, and there's much discussion about such things. I have no experimental evidence that a satiated razor blade is sharpened. Nobody's ever given me it's really whether you're going to have to do some very beautiful work with a microscope and everything, really know whether this razor is sharp. And nobody's given me anything. Everybody just talks about it. Somebody said that they tried it and it does work. But nobody's given me any experiment actually having done it and proving it's sharper. So I think it's very easy to have loose talk like that, and it's lots of fun, but whether I'm perfectly, as the talk came along, I already knew about my A and B particles and what happens with half octahedron, and I could see that that somebody may have known this long ago, and I think it's very interesting. You find that in in the Masons, the masonry, going back into their antiquities, they have that half, they have that pyramid, and they have showing a light and a star and this on our dollar bills. The pyramid idea, and it very much may have been discovered by humanity in this matter. But as I got into my own synergetics themselves, they themselves automatically continually reveal to me, because I know I'm dealing in events and energy, and not, as I call it, energetic, I guess called energetic synergetic geometry. And yes, I still call it that, but some totally now find with synergetics would seem to be okay. Embraces, because that's an embracing word, I don't think there's much more to say. I know theoretically, energies are processed by the geometers very powerfully, and I've talked to you about those railroad tracks of the 25 great circles going through the 12 points, and the fact we have 7 sets of great circles, and one of them is infinitely holding. That's the 6 great circles that go around the icosahedron. These are the equators. There's 12 vertexes, icosahedron, so that there's 6 equators, being 6 axi between the 12 opposite poles. And those go always, if you think about the icosahedron, here are its poles, and the equator is always the mid-edge of the triangle. It's got mid-edge, mid-edge. It never gets near the vertexes. Those are absolute energy holdings. And they are this pattern here. These are the same 6 great circles, you see. And there was a 6 great circle tensegrity hanging up here behind me yesterday. Those will hold the energy on whatever the icosahedron is. I think it is the electron. I can see how that axis, how electrons have, just electrons. And they can be taken away from an atom, because they are separate. Main answer to this question is that I can accredit really quite incisively, mathematically, high potentials that people. But when people talk to me loosely, for instance, they talk about astrology, I'm not really sure about astrology, because I know that people have patterns of what they think are constellations in the sky, and I know those are changing. Going just to the Big Dipper, the Big Bear, it's a major, where we find then that one of the stars in the handle is 100 light years away, another 78, another one 200 light years away, incredible distance behind. Seen from some other part of the universe wouldn't look like that at all. And we know that those two, the 100 year and the 200 year are moving in different directions, and in a few hundred years they will not be lined up the way they are at all now. That one is gradually changing. So that the constellation ideas that go along with astrology and so forth make astrology unfirm to me. Whereas I said I thought it had a great base that I can see, understand, and credit celestial interaction of little individuals on our planet, and that the conformations of the stars at the time they're born, I could think could have very great importance. What the vectors were that are operative of the forces of the universe must be tremendously powerfully different with each birth. I have something goes on in me all the time. I don't exclude phenomena. I'm willing to entertain, but I really do like the people who would like to talk seriously, and I find kids often take things very seriously without really getting the experimental evidence. They don't get a confirmation. They really can get into a fad then. I told you earlier, I keep alive superstitions. I keep alive all the myths, because there might be something there someday. I'm not dismissing them at all. And many of them have been good, because they've actually, that numerology began to open up a whole lot of knowledge for me of real number behavior. So that I find it many payoffs, and therefore I don't want to discourage human beings, but I do urge them, if they really are eager to know, to really get more really experiential and find out something, because they might really find something very much more exciting than what they're telling me. Now, Connie, if physical precession involves 90-degreeness, does metaphysical precession also involve 90-degreeness? Yes, I would really say so. But I've been saying that we were metaphysically misinterpreting our experience when we said I throw at 180 degrees. I throw a straight ball. I said we let go here, and the ball went there. So we were handling it mentally wrong. I find that when we begin to really understand the precession, the thinking is simply finding out what it's about. So it does not have the characteristics of thingness or the physical special case. So we have special directions in special cases. So that thinking can help you to, the metaphysical help can help you to understand what it is you really are experiencing, to encourage you to become experiential and really be incisive about your information. I would say metaphysically the following. It's very important. Put your two hands out front of your two fingers, and start moving them sideways. Now, keep looking at me. And how long can you see them? I'm still seeing my fingers. Still seeing them. I say I'm looking this way, but I'm looking out here too. That's your 90 degree. Your metaphysical is very powerful. This also relates to Mehdi's question about intuition. What is intuition? And I find intuition is, I call it the twilight between the conscious and the subconscious. There's no question about subconscious. There's no question about my heart being coordinated, going on, beating all the time without my doing anything about it. There's no question that I have the experience of saying, what is that man's name? And my subconscious goes to work and suddenly brings me back the name. There's no question about it. I say, I want to wake up at such and such a time, and if I don't have an alarm clock, I wake up, right? I can wake up at 7:15 or 7:13. That we're counting internally all the time anyway. We have so many rhythms, it's really quite possible to do that. And I've do this really a very great deal. And so I have any number of proofs to myself of subconscious activity, which then becomes conscious. And I know that I go to sleep and I carry on, I wake up. So every time I'm asleep, I'm subconsciously operative. So that what I call then the intuition is a twilight zone existing between the subconscious and, because I don't think that the line is sharp. I think that it can vary. And at times one gets a little bigger and the other a little smaller. They're pulsative. They have tides. So this kind of thing that I'm really quite busy looking this way, and something makes me look over there. that I'm trying to give you a 90 degree metaphysical. that metaphysical tells me to turn. I better look over here all of a sudden. Maybe it's this kind of a hint, and maybe it's a sound. Maybe it's just because there's a pattern that I've experienced before, which tells me that I better look aside. So I can see that there can be a metaphysical 90-degreeness, watching there all the time, being very careful. Then I'll take you to metaphysical 90-degreeness, where I spoke to you about all of our economic charts are Newtonian, and the baseline is 90 degrees. And you find all of our curves of everything's been happening in our civilization. We grow faster and faster, and we do more, see more and more of the world. All the curves are increasing, getting more and more abnormal. And they're getting into almost verticality. The acceleration factor is so high. So we say all of humanity is becoming so abnormal, we're coming into race schizophrenia. But I see that if I take the Einsteinian normal, the normal is that is 186,000 miles a second, and any other speed has to be accounted for by the energies intercepting one another and tying themselves in local knots, which is really beautifully proven. That did come out with Fission, who definitely demonstrated this exactly where you could predict how much energy is in any given matter. So that I find then the Einsteinian norm of constant motion into transformation and 186,000 miles a second is normal. Therefore, if I take motion and change as normal, and Newton was not only the norm of baseline, but his first law of motion said a body persists in a state of rest or in a line of motion except it's affected by other bodies. At rest is the norm. Anybody threw anything new, it came to rest over there. Because they didn't think bigger than the world, because the world was standing still in the universe at that time. So the norm was at rest. And so death was the only thing that was really normal. They had the quick and the dead. And dead was absolutely normal. That's the eternity. So I find then the Newtonian showing man going into race schizophrenic due to the acceleration and so forth, I turned the chart 90 degrees metaphysically. Then I find that man was in a tailspin, just about to crash and pulling out in a straight level flight. So this is a metaphysical 90 degree reorientation, taking it, which is your base. Is that fairly satisfactory, Connie? Do you feel that a knowledge of politics and or economics is necessary to make major contributions to humanity? You say naivety is invaluable. Wouldn't it stand in the way of comprehensive anticipatory design science? They're really two different questions, all right? The politics and I think it's very good to have knowledge of economics. I don't think you can do design science without economics, but I have to say what I mean by economics. The word economics in Greek did derive from the word ecology. And this was the ecol, the house. The call is the house, and the management of the house. And the word economics comes from that. So I think we're dealing then environment controls, and there is the environment, which is the whole universe. As an environment to each must be all that is accepting me, and universe, the only difference between universe and environment is me, the observer. So then my environment could be very big, or it could be a local environment. As for instance, the biosphere of our little spaceship Earth. this is a very local environment, an even more local environment, this room that we're in here. But each one of those, a call then really is this collection, with the one we're really talking about, this particular one. These are economics. And the energy, the metabolics of that, what I taught many quite a while ago, my grand strategy of design science and world gaming is have internal metabolics and external metabolics. External metabolics are economics. And to make them in the terms of just a cow or just in terms of a coin or money is where we've gotten into confusion. Rather than bring it on to what I call a cosmic accounting basis. And the cosmic accounting really does deal in these energies. How much in producing oil, a great refinery, you take all kinds of energies that are going into heating this fractionating column or whatever it may be. They figure the energies put in here and taken out there incredibly carefully. That's the way the universe works. If the people who were then exploiting oil and really had took the work that their engineers do in designing a refinery, I've been through this refinery design, it's an extraordinary matter. The exquisite accuracy which they know how much energy they take from this or that and turning that energy to the larger account where they're going to cash in on the what they're making with it. Well, so economics, when they're energy economics and motion economics and Newtonian economics, I think those are very essential to your design science and to you and I being useful to our fellow men, to humanity. So the naivety, I really mean then not knowing at all, not saying, I understand that and I'm not going to listen. The naivety is really to be really quite a sucker about everything, really. Somebody's attracting you and say that something going on, a safety raises, to be naive enough to say it could be something. But go on a little further and look into it more. But I think an enormous number of people miss and think simply because I know that. That goes on a very great deal. And I know my own propensity just to be that stupid. Particularly if I'm tired, I know that. So I really have to watch. I've had to watch that. I really deliberately try to keep myself as a child. And the child is naive. That's what the word means, being as a child. I did everything I could to recover my sensitivity of a child, because all the people who were talking to me when they're telling you, never mind what you think, said, you've got to get over your sensitivity. This is a tough world, and there's going to be a moment you have to do something pretty tough. You're going to say, well, get over that sensitivity. So I kept trying and started learning the game. You really had to get over the sensitivity. But when I tried to get myself in my own thinking again, I did everything. I hope I haven't lost the sensitivity I really was born with. Can I open it up again? Sure enough, I did. So I'm enjoying life. I feel very much about life as I did as a little child. I get just as excited really looking at the flowers as I did when I was a child. I got a time when I was pretty blasé about that flower. There's something you send to funerals and make the girl feel good. A bribe, a lever. You made much mention of the tet, octacube, and icosa. The dodecahedron is a Platonic solid, too. Why didn't it have a place in your mathematics? I said, I gave you something about the domains. Topologically, there is a domain of vertices and the domains of edges and the domains of faces. The domains of the faces was a face. The domain of an edge was a diamond. And the domain of a vertex is a connecting centers of gravity to the triangles around. I only deal in structural systems and they have to be triangulated. The dodecahedron is are the domains of the vertexes of the icosahedron. But if you make a dodecahedron as a necklace like this, you find it just collapses, just like the cube. So it isn't a structure, and that's why I only deal in the cube as a structure, and I do all its accounting as a structure by triangulating it. So if I triangulate the dodecahedron, then it turns out to be icosahedron. I've got to put in a battery. Strange feeling as you begin to hear yourself in very peculiar ways if your hearing aids are beginning to fail. It's a whole new problem with hearing aids. You have to really learn to live with them. The doctor said if I could really put up with it a couple of years, then I'd suddenly begin to find the human brain is so extraordinary, it begins to sort out what it is you do want to hear, but they just give me incredible noises. But now I'm really getting now I've been using quite a few years, and I'm beginning to really get a great deal out of them. And this compensation business, I'm sure that if I hadn't hearing aids, I would have stopped trying to hear. And it'd be quite easy to get old and just enjoy your own thoughts and keep going over, and you read a lot. But with them and trying to hear, I've again really helped me to recover that childish business. I listen terribly hard, you have no idea. And I'm sure this keeps me very alive. Does that answer the platonic business? And then, because it just was not in the structure class. Does the metaphysical universe employ spatial relationships such as vectors or shapes? Yes, because I said, what was, I think, absolutely unique as far as my own, any contribution I've been able to make in synergetics was introducing the conceptuality independent of size and time. So I have the tetrahedron. These are conceptual structural systems. And as I say, what does that triangle consist of? One material? I don't know at all. I really can see tetrahedron conceptually without having any particular material. The insinus, outsinus business, there's something that I can associate really motions itself without actually having to say what the material is, though. Because we have such an extraordinary frame of reference, our own insinus, outsinus, so forth. And anything we think about that has any substance, any think of system, thinkability requires a system. And anything that is actually identifiable, as any location is going to have an insinus, outsinus. So there's a metaphysical universe employs, so the metaphysical is my mental activity, so that it does employ the spatial vectors and so on. Can human relationship be described as joining of shapes, convergence of vectors, and so on? Very much so. It's rather dull, but you can really get down into making the vectors of the approaching things, and we can really get the vectors. In fact, we get close with the critical proximity, we can feel heat and all anything else. There are vectorial things going on very powerfully. Actually, can be described as forces. The metaphysical inner effects, I don't think you can describe with vectors. The physicals, yes. How do other peoples around the world feel about a cooperating, trusting, one-town world? How far is humanity from realizing this? How urgent is the need to act soon? How likely to see the fail? I have fortunately traveled around the world, and I have talked to the human beings everywhere. And one of the things that really has impressed me in Russia, the Russians can't understand why Americans and Russians shouldn't be getting on absolutely superbly. I'm not talking about the politicians, the leaders, the people themselves. They just don't understand why we can't get on. What's going on? In the Arabs, Israeli, I've talked to many, many, and absolutely good feeling. Couldn't be better. And there's a people's resentment around the world of the political manipulation of them, making them, putting them against one another. And realizing how terrifically they're propagandized to feel the way they do. Going back and forth as much as I do, being in India when I found the United States papers I really shocked in my New York Times. I really thought it was pretty reliable. But I found the New York Times reporter in India not being faithful to what was going on there. And he was really participating in propaganda. Whether he had a political job and had that job mixed up, I'm afraid that was in there. But it was really, there was some treachery of information in humanity going on. So I think my answer to you is that the people are ready everywhere. They were very much welcome. How quickly people, this phenomenon of trust, every child is born with trust. has to. It's absolutely dependent on that parent. That the breast is going to be there, whatever's necessary for a long, long time. And when a child lying in bed, his drunken parents suddenly, in a fight or another, I assure you, this trust gets very, very greatly shattered. These things are very, very delicate. And it's hard to find the tiny little things that suddenly make little human beings really skeptical about other human beings. But there is a born trust, and it will persist so long as it doesn't have very important evidence that is not to be trusted. When they say the mother and father and drunken men and father's leaving home, you know, these angry voices, and this little child really may not know what the words are, but really feels absolute insecurity all of a sudden. The urgency to act is always there. I think it's always been through all history. All history calls for integrity of the human beings, and fortunately, I think very large number of human beings acting in extraordinary integrity. And even the ones who seemingly are bad, because they've been taught the game, and they're really quite convinced of the game they're playing. I don't see businessmen as bad people at all, but I think they really are caught in a convinced of a game being valid, and where they haven't had the right information, and very easy to get people to play the wrong games. So the big thing is integrity is required at all times. So then how likely to succeed or fail, that I feel is absolutely touch and go down. And I think the whole difference whether we do or not is actually lies with each one of us, and really the little things each one of us are doing. If I don't personally feel the need to pick up the paper to clean up my own mess, if I don't feel that, it's going to go this way like wildfire. Everything's going to pieces. I've got to feel it about everything I do, and I do feel it that way all the time now, much more than I ever have. All my life I've had this feeling, but much more now than I really feel. The times I've let things go a little, but I must not let go anymore. I think humanity is really in being weighed. I call it really some final exam, and humanity is not marking the papers. No politics in marking the papers. Are we really going to qualify to graduate, to be more responsible than just really thinking that we're the whole world, we're the whole universe, and all. We tend to be prone to think that the universe is here to please us or displease us. Stars are just a decoration. Are we really going to graduate where we begin to put ourselves in the right magnitude and really realize that we're here to really use this beautiful thing, and its truth is just not something you traffic. You know, there's no temporizing the truth, whatever it is. You go with it. So, what are your predictions for future years? I can give, I know what their options are. I know that their things can go, and I can really spell out. And the particular thing that I gave you to read last night, as I go in the last parts there, ways what would happen if you then stop wasting the fuel to go to false jobs that are not producing life support, and you can begin to see how the economies work out. I spelled that out quite clearly in that piece that I gave you. I think that I know those are options. But whether we're going to make it or not, it's quite a different thing. So I can't make any prediction that's where we're going to go. I know those are options, and there are probably other options. But as to, somewhat along the lines that I put there, seem to be the prominent way in which rivers would flow if you did this and that. A good question, Connie. question for Janet. Is it as valid or as valuable for a person to devote his time and energy to playing music, painting, or writing poetry, as it is to devote time and energy to shelter, healing, and so forth? I think this is very, very much a matter of the individual. And here is where the intuition really do play a very important part. And I know my artist friends just really did do painting and so forth, my friends who have been musicians, have helped me a great deal to do what I do. they have loved me, we've been friends, and they inspire me, and apparently what I do inspires them. So the main thing is integrity with self, because we are, nature does have butterflies and she has lilies, they're different. And they're very intercontributory, and there's great cross-pollinizing goes on in the affection, the harmonics. The metaphysical cross-pollinization is harmonics. The things that really either inspire very positively or might irritate them, that make, force you to precess or something. So, as far as I'm concerned, out of validity, it's just a matter of integrity. This person really feeling very much like a painter, be sure to paint. Be sure to do it. That's the language. I see artist after artist that I know who did not stay in school very long, and they were very often the dropouts. And they were, to me, very probably dropouts, because as they're being exposed to information and the way they've been taught about language, how to write and so forth, it didn't feel right. This is not intellectual decision at all, but it just didn't feel right. The artist then had, I say, every child is born genius, and their genius is, they're intuitively threatened. And they really clam up. They don't know why they're climbing up, and they don't want to be a bad boy, but they're just not getting on. Because I think they're absolutely protecting something in them. So many, many of my artist friends simply would drop out that way, just clammed up. But that was not the language they liked to speak. They had a visual language instead of hearing language, etc. So they wanted to paint. This way they talk. You do any music. You speak that way. I think it depends what language you feel that you'll be most effective in. That's really the artist. This economic crisis, recession, inflation, whatever we are passing through, it is beginning to seem like the stories I've heard about the 30s depression. Is it similar? Is it going to get worse? It is not similar. It's incredibly different. The other one came on, society wasn't expecting it at all. I was amazed by it. That 4D that you have. You find that letter to my mother about the stock market and about selling railroad bonds and things like that. That 4D was written 2 years before the economic, before the 29 crash. And I could see it coming, and I really tried to tell people that it's coming in many ways. If you read there carefully, you find, as I talk to people in this, and in that stock world and so forth, I'm saying those things. Anyway, there were not many people that had stocks and bonds. That's a very, very esoteric subject. Society just didn't know what had happened. They were not thinking much about banking. The society was extraordinarily naive. And they didn't really know what happened. I say many people were in it and don't know today what it was all about. Just it was a depression. And it had a very... It was depressing. One reason it was a great depression. The people really stopped being communicative. I told you the in those days the number of literates were very much lower. The vocabularies were less. And people began to just get sitting in rooms, not doing anything. It was a very stagnating kind of thing. No. There was no protest down the street, just suddenly things began to be wrong, and the newspapers, the financial world kept trying to say stupid things, and prosperity is just around the corner and all the nonsense. And you heard just exactly the same thing in the Nixon government and so forth. There's nothing wrong here, nothing wrong. So we're just suddenly, so obviously, but all the time it was wrong. So that there's been much more education about what's going on, and this time the issues are different. That was the beginning, really, as Roosevelt's term was, the forgotten man. But the forgotten man is very much in today. So it really is an everybody based. And it was not at that time. It was still very... And I said this poker hands business showing that there was, in those days, a respect for power. It's incredible. For which reason the poor of those days, when they did get the money, immediately wanted all the labor man who made stunning money, then got a lot of things. His kids didn't like it, but dad got marks of distinction. It was the association, the superficial associations, had very powerful psychological effects they don't have anymore. The society had really been completely purged of that kind of a feeling. So what is so very different this one is that the young people in my day were not supposed to know anything. The older people knew everything. So the young people just sitting around anyway, and leaving to older people. And the older people were in confusion. But today, all the young people have been purged of the respect for superficial grandeur and strength. And so the base is different. I actually find around the world, Don, because having just been coming around again, I find everybody really very cheery. You hear things are awful in England, it couldn't be nicer in England. Everybody's feeling great. I assure you. The newspapers keep saying that, and they want to have the other people. There was our newspapers like to have the other people in much worse condition than we are. We're pretty bad with everybody else. Away. But I find people around the world really are very expectant. They're expecting something good coming out of this. And the other times you thought you got to leave it to politics so that you did finally get in a new deal. Everything, the whole hope was about the leader. But the people don't do anything. You have to elect a big father, and the big father decides what to do. That's not where people are now. They really are all feeling. What makes me say what I do, and that I think you saw the piece I wrote to, which will be coming out in the Philadelphia News. I think we're coming to where politics, somebody say, what kind of politics are we going to go to? My communist friends say, if you don't join up with the communists, and this all the way back in the 30s, what are you going to have? And I said, you don't have to have a government. So, what are you talking about? Of course you have. You don't. We do have spontaneous in commitments, so we're off cruising in my boat, or we're going around the world, and we're crew on a ship, a sailing ship. I assure you, every sailor knows what every sailor does on that ship. And you don't need any politicians when something goes wrong to know what to do. You really do, you know your job, and the other guy is doing it, and you really know he's doing it. If anything went wrong with him, the only reason he wouldn't do it is because he's actually been hurt. With a spontaneous coordination, and everybody can see the other guy really at work. What fascinates me is the sea and the sailor. I see them in incredible condition. They really do fight for that ship. But even then, you get work. There's another ship that's much worse condition. This one's getting on, having a pretty hard time. This one, they're really going to perish. And the people this ship will go on after the people in the worst condition. But on the land, and they won't even stop, and the people are dying beside the road. I find man on the land does not behave very well, but the ship of the sea really is told. If there's anything that's anathema to a sailor, it is a seagoing politician. It stinks. You know how many lawyers, sea lawyers are gone. So that I can see you can really get on very nicely without any politician telling you what to do. There are And you do develop codes and you develop laws. Laws are important. I think that we may unquestionably have something we call city managements. May very much have administrations, but we're going to have people, nobody's going to be doing what they're doing because it's a job and has to do anything to make money. Everybody's going to be doing that job because he would like to really be doing something. He'd like to be making a contribution. This is one that feels good to him. One of the things that is rather sadly found in America today, I can understand it, and I'm glad that we've had labor unions and so forth, but the money makers have made such a battle between labor and the money maker that they get tougher and tougher, and Howard Johnson really takes on kids that are pretty high up and gives them much more to do, and that one person has to wait on 20 tables and so forth. But forget it. Even in England, where they've had plenty of labor organization, people still really love their jobs, and they're really doing the job because they like the job. And there really is a great, they're having fun at serving at the table, and all the conversation goes on. That used to exist in America, but with the hardness of business and the firming up of labor, which was very great, that did happen. Really, almost complete joy is going on in most things. It's very, very hard cock punching. So I simply say, once we disconnect the idea of how do you carry on and live from the doing the job, people are going to want to do jobs. They're going to want to do beautiful jobs. They're not all going to want to do the same jobs. I'm glad somebody does want to paint, and somebody else wants to sing, and somebody else wants to. I personally would very much enjoy waiting on table. It can be a very, very conversational kind of a job. Very informative. This economic crisis, you asked me that, and I said, no, it's not similar. It's very, very different. And people didn't seem to have any idea what was going to come out in those days. I was publishing my Shelter magazine here in Philadelphia at that time. We do have copies of that over in the office, and you can read, because I quote all the newspapers in there, what's being said at that time. You really get quite a feeling about it there. And I did feel that my kind of structure and things would have something to do with things but I didn't expect them to happen for 50 years, and I didn't think they'd be immediately of importance. I did work on the idea at that time of buildings that were empty, and business were empty. But the property owners felt so strongly about them that the Empire State had just been finished and had crashed. This incredibly big building, nobody in it. So I made drawings of how it could be used for it, called Space Hotel, and moved all the people in there who were sleeping in the subways and things. And there was not much enthusiasm about that in the homeowners. I was surprised that the veterans of World War I, with the Depression on, thinking something ought to be done in Washington, got up a march to Washington, and they encamped over where the Pentagon now is, which is just more or less marshy lands over there. And they, very so annoying to the still in Republicans, Hoover and others, this when General MacArthur drove them out. And they then marched to New York. And because of my publishing my Shelter magazine, their leader came to see me. And I tried very hard to find some place where they could be housed in New York. And I was finally gratified that I couldn't get any of the churches paying attention to them. The subway stairs were all full of just the New Yorkers already there. People really sleeping all over. It's a little warm in that subway. And the Guaranteed Trust Company had a lot of properties on the Lower East Side, where today the enormous housing development, but really terrible old housing, really terrible, messy, just like Detroit, much of Detroit looks to me. And they let me have one of those buildings, and then another one, and the floors had all gone. These men moved in, they repaired all the floors. They found the neighborhood was wonderful, let them have scraps of boards and things. They got the floors repaired. They had laid out newspapers on the floor so something to lie on. They used to try to keep up the morale, they used to have drilling every day to sort of get them. And the butcher at the end of the week, foods that he hadn't sold, they have to get rid of because they're going to invest. So he gave them his food. We found the community as being wonderful to these people. I was only able to take care of a certain number of them, but I did have them, and I have quite a lot about that in Shelter magazine. If you go back and read that, I have pictures of the work that they did repairing the buildings. When the New Deal came in, they took on these people and the WPA, and they sent them down to work on the Florida Keys Highway, the bridges, and they were all on Metacombi Key. I'm sorry to say, the minute they began to get some money, then they'd been through such rough things. They did much drinking. They were getting pretty messy. They had just been pushed around as half dregs of humanity. Metacombi Key, and there was a great, incredible hurricane, and wiped them all out. This is a story. I sort of felt God just cleaned that up. So decided to get them in a better condition. They were not recoverable. They were living in railroad cars down there on the quay, and it was not a good life. And the WPA thing was not being ministered into a friendly way. It was a mess. It was a handout and an almost really ignominy. They were not being honored. How many miles per gallon of gas did your Dumex in car get? Well, remember, it carried 11 passengers, so I rated really in terms of passenger miles. But I did get up to, due to this low drag, I did get up to as much as 30 miles to a gallon. There's some total cruising. I think she was running around 20, but this would be for 11 passengers. So if I take the gallons per passenger mile, she was very low. I changed the driving ratio and 2.8 to 1, so that the low drag, I could get my engine, which is really peaking, to get my wheels moving around very fast. Once while explaining your rethinking of the Lord's Prayer, you mentioned the physical accelerating and the metaphysical trending to slow down to eternity. Would you explain that statement? As I said, man is apparently the physical norm being 186,000 miles a second of energy unfettered in vacuo. As we begin to employ the energies, we tend to get... We're not going so fast because our Earth's going 60,000 miles an hour around the sun, so getting up to 100 miles an hour over the land isn't something very impressive. We are going faster, but so I find physical accomplishments more rapid, to the point that there's such an acceleration that you and I are experiencing in days, but in terms of total numbers of experiences and changes of information, changes we have to make in adjusting, they were an enormous acceleration compared to our forebears. But I find then the metaphysical, we learn a little about that precession. And then how do you describe it properly? We've got some equations for it, and it's done in quantum mechanics. Get a little more simplified. But we're dealing in the metaphysical is really dealing in those generalizations. The generalizations themselves are eternal. And as the Heisenberg principle shows, we can't get to be absolutely exact. The act of measuring alters that which is measured. So what we do is we have finer and finer tolerance. We'll tolerate less error. We find a way of getting to say it a little more accurately. But the more accurately you say it, the less frequently you're going to change what you say. That you understand that? That really is a metaphysical slowing down, because we're dealing in the eternity where there's no change at all. So you get the universe is always showing these balances, and then the motion one just only gets to a limit of 186,000 miles a second. It doesn't go on accelerating beyond that. That is the maximum. But it works back, really, to everything works back to the eternity of no change. That's the end of Janet, and Janet's question, not the end of Janet. Andy Howard, what kind of educational systems would you propose for teaching comprehensive anticipatory design science? I don't know of any educational system that is being formally made available to society today that does it. That's why we're doing what we're doing, for instance. And I have really developed what I have outside, and I've tried to let you know as we go on here the way in which what you and I as human beings can do with another human being who wants to learn. But as I gave you the child having to have the experience, and then you're able to enlarge that experience pattern by saying, I've had that, but I did this a little more. You can help the child then to get, maybe a child may have had seven experiences and you give him one more, and that might be, you really need about eight for a sort of synergetic effect for it suddenly to see a principle. So I said, as far as I'm concerned, all we can do is to add to the experience inventory of the little individual. And we can say that it's been my experience that I have learned that there are principles, and you can be on the key V for one if you like. And you might be really right for it. You might help them synergetically then to see that principle that it is manifest in what they've been experiencing. Otherwise, you could get to teaching, as I did, the great skier at Aspen, Colorado, that what he was doing was angular valving of gravity. And he agreed that's exactly what he's doing, and he was terribly excited to find it out with his soul, that he could see that really was a proper scientific description. So, but you have to have the experience base. Otherwise, I think, Andy, there is a whole lot for us to learn about how to help, how to, what we can do on behalf of the other human being to give them advantage what we have learned. But they number one, they must have a real desire for it. And you give it to answer the kid's question he's asking. We all have very different appetite schedules of what we're interested in today. And to assume that all the kids are going to be interested in exactly the same thing the same day, nothing could be less logical. So one reason this kid is climbing up, he's not interested in that at all. So I think that we've got to find ways for the individual to get the information it wants when it wants it, when there's a terrific appetite driving for it. And I think that's going to come through K-sets where the kids can plug in. They want the information instead of, they do, they hadn't learned, they could go to the shelf and that encyclopedia is sort of fun to look at. And you do find the sort of interrelatedness. So you could figure out how to look up things in encyclopedia by yourself. I think they'll learn how to find their way around calling up the case sets that they want. They could get a little on, a little look better on, and so forth. And I'm confident that, as I say in my book, I have a book on this, Education Automation, that our real studying we do by ourselves. And we do not prosper by being in a room and the teacher's asking a little kid to get up. The kid doesn't feel like getting up. And performing, and it gets confusing. And doesn't give the right answer, and they say you're no good, or so forth. I think it is an absolutely cruel and devastating way to try to carry on. I think you have social experiences together, but studying you do by yourself. It's absolutely optional. And you ought to be able to learn how to mark your own paper. And you get that information, find it, because you really like knowing. And you find, I'm a very different rate of apprehending. I really have to read things a whole lot of times. Other people read through it quite fast. These are different traits. So I want that quite a lot of times, and I really want to check myself out. When I learn it that way, nobody can shake me. I really learned my own experimental following around there. So my answer to you, I don't think the system exists, Andy, but I think it's formulating very rapidly. I think that the electronics mean are going to be very, very important. And that whole matter is being opposed by all the people who are so scared they're not going to earn a living. The number of people are committed to how I earn a living by a teaching job and looking for tenure. And they're just the most powerful people in that whole education system really holding back on any cassettes or anything like that. So it's not being officially fostered at all, what you're talking about. But it is coming out of the commitment of human beings and ingenuity, millions of people really like to help the kids, and who are scholars and realize that the other things will work better. And the facility is developing quite rapidly. I find electronics things themselves are improving. We've talked about it, that this station we're right here in this bell, it really concerned because Philips and RCA and NBC do not move a little faster, CBS, about the cassettes. But they are going to be, they hook up to your television, and you're going to, the Philips one I said was on these records that you can just fold up and mail, and it's really a flawless kind of record, so the most information being the tightest package, really, at least destructible, so that I think that one of those is going to work. Philips runs around $1,000 to $1,600, and the RCA says they have one coming next year, $600. But this has not been resolved. When the cassettes really come in, and you can really plug in anything you want from all around the world, and about this time we're going to go through a whole lot before Russia and China, we're going to let satellites really begin to relay information very freely, but that will come too. But when the kids can really get information from all around the world, with all the computers really being interhooked, and you know where's that information, they're going to go and get it. They really are going to go and get it. What strategies can be employed to overcome the inertia existing in the home building industry? Well, number one, the carriage trade did not change. Produce the automobile, and the people armorers didn't develop the airplane. So don't look to the building industry for anything at all. But what can be done? I hope I've exposed you a whole lot of what I've been trying to do for about half a century, working on how do you develop environmental control very economically and delicately, and that's what really so much of my discourse has been on. On the Dimex in-house, where I cut down to 3 tons, which did more than 150 tons at the time. I was really down to a very low figure already, and now I can go very much further with the geodesic, where say I can give you 300 buildings for one. And so the solution is going to be to have man stop using his highest production and scientific capability for the killer industry, but you turn this in the direction of making man a success of producing the air deliverable dwelling service. So you and I ought to be able then to say, I'd like to be live in that mountaintop, and then would you have me a shelter up there this afternoon, and I'm going to fly up, and you ought to be able to rent it for a couple of dollars a year. That's really all it should be. So no particular reason why you should come in to the city, except you really like to meet people and so forth, do what you may be doing now, whatever it is. But that's the way it's going to be solved. So, what strategies can be employed? Really, do study. That found my books. I don't know how much of my books you've read. I'm sure you've read quite a lot now. But that has all been that is the grand strategy. To do more with less and to employ the highest capabilities of man to take this prime task of looking out for human beings. If, as Einstein suggests, motion is normal and everything else exists in a field of flux, how can an event be described as a finite energy package? The word package is the wrong thing. We have found that the photon and so forth, the energy does occur in quanta. I should have said quanta instead of saying package. And the event occurs and this continues. Physics have found no continuums. Events discontinue. Does that answer you properly?
Huh? I think so.
Yeah. That's why I gave you your last finite packages seem to describe a universe with continual stop and goes rather with a continual flowing reality. And I gave you the scenario where this man was born and he has his children and so forth and he gets to be grandpa and he's died, but there are other, I call it an aggregate of non-simultaneous and partially overlapping energy events, so it makes a complete web, a tapestry, like this is a rope. All the different threads keep coming in at different points, and they all overlap. It's a beautiful continuity, but it must be thought of that way. That thread ends, and another one reels here. They're not end-to-end, it's an overlapping affair. That's our continual flowing reality. Somebody just died, somebody's just born. Bing, that's just happened again. He's overlapping all the time in here. A trolley over there just stopped and another stop. It's all just stop and go. This is from Ed Applewhite, about what is the rationale for the powering of the Shahrazad numbers. Do Bauer selected always reveal? He then gives the 9 million and the 14 million numbers, and my primes only go up to 17, to the second power. All the rest are single powers. This is simply because in doing my exploring, because I kept looking for these numbers and then finally from time to time coming to the sublime and rememberable, I realized that the doubling in just in probability, the reoccurrence of the number two as a necessity of halving or multiplying is very high, and the numbers of time you need to get into 43 periodicity is very low. So the 17 sunny, which would get a second power, if I have an octave 8, that would be 16, so the prime number 13 would be all you needed. But I find then with an octave system where we have nines, but those are zeros, and they are, these zeros, incidentally, are absolutely essential to the accommodating of the odd waves and the energy discontinuities. And the only reason we can have any waves going through rooms or was because it's simply a matter of relative frequencies. Things, there's nothing here at the time, so nothing interfere. These are the typicals that make possible electromagnetic wave propagation. But nine then is a zero, and fascinated if I begin to show you the way that zero begins to function in the closest packing of spheres and so forth. Let's have, and I can have, here's a triangle, there's a triangle. But only one of them can own this one. This is common, the two. And we find that in the periodicities of which, this one of the things that brought me great rewards in my numerology, I found that where systems cross up like that, the nines occur every time. They make an actual hollow, a space for one side or the other to go through. Okay? This was a... Ten. When I get to doing it this way, I found that where... This is a nucleus, you remember, when I go around building around the nucleus. This occurs in that nine position, time and again, the zero position. But one side or the other can go through that nucleus. There were 12 degrees of freedom, but one will go through it at a time. Can you understand that? So it acted as an accommodating space necessary to the universe. Anyway, Sonny, 17 then gave me all the prime numbers up to 18, which are the two nines. So if you're counting the nines, gave me both a positive and negative octave. And from there on, I didn't think the frequency of use of the prime numbers doesn't seem to show up. The probability is very low. That good answer? Comprehensive and testimonial design science, this is Cindy. In your visions, if we are able to effectively design our future, how will man be living on this earth in the years to come? Tell us more of your dreams of the future. What patterns, what systems are to be affected? What about the future of the greatest, most complex tool of all, society? Well, I just say, no society know me, no otherness know me. I'm the product of two to start off with. And I say no awareness, no life, and no otherness, no awareness. But Cindy, I feel that mainly I predicate everything on my working assumption that we are given mind and we don't know any other phenomena having it, and that the mind can discover and have reference to the generalized principles of universe, and the generalized, when you have a complex of principles which are all interaccommodative, we have then a design, because to me a design in contradistinction to randomness or disorder is that all the parts are interaccommodative. They're designed that way. That's what you call a design. To find that all these absolutely independent, extraordinary laws are all interaccommodative, I say, then tells me human mind has had access to a little corner of the great design principles of the universe. This is extraordinary to me. That's overwhelming. Therefore, this must be for a very important reason. And I say, and I read that as meaning that we were to be a local monitor dealing with a universe and a complete intertransformation everywhere, in incredible frequencies and many, many options, and is bound in making daisies and galaxies to have certain problem times, that we're here really for problem solving. I think I see us then as being operative in much larger range of universe. While our astronomers are dealing great distances already, and we do have some space activity, I think we're going to be very deeply concerned with, much more concerned with the universe in a big way than we ever have before. Well, you're not being concerned about how you're going to earn a living. The minute we really take that nonsense out, and we will, the kind of interest you have just as a child, really trying to understand stars, man is really going to go. He's going to be deep in the microcosm, deep in the macrocosm. He's going to go back and archaeologically rebuild all the cities of yesterday. He's going to take things out of the museums and put things back where they were originally. Nobody's trying to steal now, because there's no reason vandalizing to steal. Therefore, you'll be able to go and live in the way you go live 3,000 years ago and 5,000 years ago. Say it to be done, and they'd be really very exciting. So you not only range around geographically and so forth, but you're going to be go back and forth in time. You're going to do some very, very interesting things. That's about all I can say. I think the main thing is when I say I'm giving you a fellowship and to think, and you say, well, do you want me to sit in the schoolhouse to do that? I said, no. I said, can I go fishing? You say, great, yeah, that's a great place to think. So while you're out there fishing and thinking, I said, I want you to think about the fact when you get through fishing, you don't have to go and cheat somebody else out of their job so your family can eat. You don't have to tell a lie when you got that man's job or something. So you're going to say, what else was I thinking about before they told me I had to have a job? And you suddenly get back in that wonderful continuity of the child. Really the freshness and the eagerness and interest in the universe. Expand more fully concepts of the 12 freedoms in physics and in the physical universe. I did to give you the wire wheel which needed a minimum of 12 spokes. I gave you the ball on a string fastened to a pole, which we call tether balls, so one restraint. Then I expected two restraints and finally when I had two restraints, it was as if you're in the middle of a violin string, you couldn't make a whole sphere anymore, a wavy sphere. Now you could only operate in a plane. Then I had a third restraint, you could only operate in a line. That's in the middle of the drum head, and then I gave you four restraints, and you seemingly couldn't go anywhere, but you could find you wriggle around locally. Not that I had 12 restraints, could I stop even wiggling locally. So then you became part of a system, which operated as a system. Is that not clear, and it's all right? But there are then, because there are, everything in the universe is multiple, divisible by two. There is unity is plural, minimum two. That is there. And there will always be two poles to any system. And there's another kind of two-ness, the inside-ness, outside-ness. As I said, there's multiplicative two-ness and the additive two-ness. The poles themselves are the additive two-ness but two-ness. So all the topological accounting, you always come out with the numbers of vertexes always be divisible by two, and so will the number of faces, and so will the number of edges. But when I said I took out the two polar two, the polar two, removed it, then I found that the relative abundance from there on was that for every vertex there were always two faces, and there was always three edges, because there are always two vertexes anyway. Therefore, there are always four faces and six edges. And those six edges are the edges of the tetrahedron or the minimum structural system. So at every event, you're always going to have six. There's six linear moves, six vectorial moves. I said you could go around in a hexagon, come back where you started, or you could be six places away. Because of the options, every one of those values, every time you have a play, you got six moves. you can only use two checkerboards, but you get six moves, or whatever may I'm saying. You only have four checkerboards, but you make six moves on four checkers. And this means that you could be, that's the reason that we have positional differentials in the universe, that there isn't a spatial differential due to those freedoms. You understand that? And why there's any time lag? Because under so many dispositions, it's going to take longer to get back there again. So that sixness, the twelve, each one is positive and each is negative. So there are 12 degrees of freedom. The sixness also made it realize there's a push and a pull. So there are actually 12 forces, 12 vectors involved. How do you describe thinking? This is Jack. I don't try to describe thinking. What I said I do is to try to say, what is my conscious, what am I conscious of doing when I say I am thinking? I said that I found that it started with a spontaneous interest in something. That's already underway, so this, in my conscious part I got to was simply dismissing irrelevancies, and that's something happened, the subconscious does the rest. And suddenly finds us, I keep putting the grass apart, I put the irrelevancies apart, and suddenly there is a path, there's a relationship I was looking for. So, I've described operationally what I do when I say I'm thinking, but I assume that really it goes on subconsciously, Jack. Then I said, describe a thought, however, was a thinkable set and differentiable from a finite but non-unitarily conceptual universe. Because it's a scenario and I can't see all the pictures at once. I can get a meaning out of a continuity, a section of the continuity, but I don't know when it ends. A thinkable, so I found a thinkable set is what I gave you. It's a system that had an inside and an outside. It had a macrocosmic irrelevancy and a microcosmic irrelevancy, but there was a lucid set of stars of this magnitude, just the right ones. That's a thinkable set. So I could really describe a thought as having insideness and outsideness. And really, there's some geometrical description of the thought. What do you believe to be the relation of pure thought to language? I don't use the word pure, Jack. I don't use the word believe. I can sort of speculatively reconsider experiences and I can zero in on a special something. I find what your question interesting, therefore I suddenly find I'm thinking spontaneously. Relationship of pure thought to language. I don't know what pure thought would be, but I did give you how I cope with operational description of the what goes on when I say I'm thinking. And I did give you a thought as having probably inside. It is the first subdivision of universe. It's a division of universe into a thinkable set, a tunable set of relevances. Now, what that relationship is to language, I've said that to me, universe is an aggregate of all humanity's consciously apprehended communicated experiences. So the word language is a communication. So the communication can be to self or to others, but that's the communication. This is the only way we have any identity or awareness of something occurring. But I think I can tell myself, I can talk to myself. I don't think I talk French and English and German to myself. So I think there is a very spontaneous conceptualizing. And what we do in the way of communicating what it is we're thinking about, that took a long, long time to really evolve the logical sounds that went with the right conceptualizing. And so it became a really sort of spontaneous way to follow along what the other man is doing. There was an awful lot of circumstance of the time that may no longer be operative. Things that people, many tools they use that we don't use today, and they're in the words. They're described probably in the word, yet we don't use that tool anymore. So the sound doesn't seem to have any, we don't know, identify anything with it. So we have a lot of those kind of words. I don't really quite know how to, my own relationship, I've described as best I could what it is I do when I'm thinking, and then I may want to communicate that to you. And I might, so there'd be several languages. I might go up to the board and make a drawing. I might write something on the board. I might make some sounds to you. Big thing, relationship between a thought and language, is that somebody wants to hear what you're thinking. So you take the trouble to communicate. They said they'd like to know what you're thinking. I would think that's the big relationship. Do you believe, like Noam Chomsky, that various languages exhibit certain universal structural characteristics, which are a function of the mechanics of mind and brain? Yes, I've in my old Nine Chances of the Moon, I did a little of this, but there's one I did called Game of Life, which was originally in Nine Chances of the Moon. I chopped it out. Ed Strasberg has recently published it. I think the S is going to be, this is arresting, arrest, and you may stop, I may start. Is a change from one to the other. This would be typical of what he's saying here, isn't it? That's a universal structural characteristic in there. And the S is really either way, to either stop or to start. It'll accommodate, but it's a change. It's a very abrupt change. S is abrupt. I think it's very structural, and what we're saying in any language. And it would not be. And just the sounds, the snakes, they're hissing. And they've used a snake with a hissing. You said Friday night the design is something a group could do. It's not something a group could do, right? This group exploration is in design science. And is group exploration in design science the world game possible in a workshop format? When I have, for instance, I take university groups and we have undertaken a produce something, I've immediately then given functions of that task and I put them up there. There isn't going to be a coordinator, assistant coordinator, for the total effort. There's going to be the mathematicians, we need some mathematics to be done, there's some drawing, there's going to be a design, and there's going to be some drafting. And there's a design of the undertaking, of the strategy, but then there's a design of the object, but there's also a design of the method of installation, there's a design of there are many different designs. But I ask the individuals to decide which one of those they'd like to do. But I call them all designs, really. The usual word about the design is just an object that the whole effort is going to produce, but I consider every bit of it design. And each one is done by an individual. I think designing is an individual function. And you can coordinate your designs of the individual designing. You can have a common objective, you handle one part of the task and you do another, but they'll both be designs. And there's a synergetics of those designs once they're done. Two observations prompt the question which follows. More than one primitive society has been discovered in which the role of the female is huntress and the male is homemaker. Two. The biological function of the male role is one of seed implanting, which can also be seen a continuous wave phenomenon. No, it is not the seed. It is fertilization, but it's not the seed. The ovary is really the seed. That contains it. And there's quite a difference between the fertilization of it. It's like the pollinization. I can understand because we really don't have the pure any absolutely pure female or pure male and mix, and I can certainly see how a set of casualties in a tribe where the male, there was a war, and they really got killed off, and the women then started having to do the task, so some of the women started. I can understand that, but we do can see really it's a general pattern of mammals, and even the water, but the males tend to sweep out larger areas than the females. So I call the sweeping out. I explained it as hunting or one thing or another, but I don't want to just use the word hunting, but the main thing is the sweeping out the large area. Am I clearing up at all? What you say? Does a male-female distinction determine biologically social patterns of behavior and role, or are the differences culturally determined and ethnocentric? There's no question to me that a female and a male have different, many different characteristics. And I, for instance, just in cold water, the female can stay in this cold water longer than the male. She has just a little extra pressure here. That's what makes her very soft, also makes her very insulated. She can be a little more naked than the male under the same thermal conditions. So there's no question that there are really physical differences here. And I would think one is mildly impeding and some another advantaging. So that I just accept as so. But individuals have very different lives, and there are so many forces that operate. Genetically and circumstantial-wise, environmental-wise, I wouldn't really try to. I certainly wouldn't try to generalize too much in here. But I've certainly got to say there's a physical difference, and I really feel very strongly about the woman being a wave phenomenon. She's opening it from inside out, and the male really does not. There's no question about it to me. Male with a penis, and he's a pusher, and she's a puller. And her tactics are that way, and she's really designed that way to have pull and to be attractive. He tends to be aggressive. That's a big thing, but that doesn't hold all the cases at all. I would not like to insist that way, Jack, at all. I'm not really being hard-edged here. They are their main forces that play very greatly complex effects in all kinds of side issues. And I see also nature also playing this game when she wants to stop propagation, and she'll make females do one thing and males do others. So we get where they're just the way they look to one another may be more conducive to propagation or not propagation, things like that go on. You and I don't know much about. These are the big trends, big waves. What are the constraints upon architecture schools and the architecture profession which seem to be so effectively inhibit the and frustrate a comprehensive approach to the environment? Just the profession of architecture, and period. It is the end of a tailoring business, and it's really a pathetic one. And yet it has, there's manliness, or there's dignity, human dignity is involved, and that there's no question about how easy it is to excite as it has excited and carry on as it has carried on. And it's very exciting when suddenly the patrons say they're going to do this, going to build a great castle, they're going to build this one. A lot of people get excited, a lot of people are going to eat for a while. And it's just fraught with excitement and romance. As our current economic crisis continues, it may be that the whole building industry and architecture profession could undertake a major reorientation during this interim period. what form might such a transformation take? I say, just really abandon it altogether and really start in, try and do some thinking. And really look into the resources of the earth and what are the tasks to be done and how do you do them best. And try to keep out. To me, the only aesthetic for tomorrow is integrity. Absolutely. That is the aesthetic. I've exercised this very rigorously in all my undertakings. I do not go in for trying to color something. I've said I mustn't. If Sandy Call liked what I was doing, and he did, I with my attention things, and he then gets into mobiles. But I've seen time and again I could exploit what I was doing as an art, and that might bring some admiration, might make some money. But that's what I'm at. I'm strictly at some problem solving in the most economical possible manner. But I must use the best materials, whatever it is. And what I say, when it's all through, if I don't think it looks beautiful, then I know I've failed. But that's the only time I really think about what's going to look out when it's finished. At all times, I must be doing the thing in the terms of what its functions are and doing that absolutely the best known and practical of our moment. And I think you may or may not feel that some of the things that I've done in my structure, I do have some beauty, but if they... I can tell you many of them didn't look very beautiful to me, because I knew something I didn't really do right. But if I really have done the things the way they should be done, they tend always to be beautiful to me. So I say the aesthetic was the integrity, and it must be integrated. It must be the synergetics and all. Recent book, Meaning in Architecture, 1973, labels you as the most extreme representative in architectural movement it calls biotechnical determinism, a neo-romantic approach to design which obtains its criteria directly from the behavior of nature and, in effect, short-circuits the process of incorporating socially meaningful symbolism in the resulting form. Such an approach, the article goes on to say, is totally functionalist, an aesthetic which denies itself as such and of no symbolic value. I'm not even mildly interested in producing symbols, except when I try to do, actually write and communicate. I like a symbol for communication, but I would not use a building as a communication, I don't think. I think it's misuse of a tool, and I don't. Many, many people made the mistake of seeing, because I have a whole lot of slides we didn't run showing you synergetics in nature. That they've said that I learned about this from nature, that I was copying nature and I simply tried to use nature forms. I never done it, ever. There was growth in form, a lot of people excited by that, and I'm sure there are a great many people who tried to make a building look like a cabbage or whatever it is. But I've never done anything like that, ever in my life. I've been astonished to find that there was a relationship between the mathematical logic I was employing, because I was simply doing the most of least, what gives me the most volume contained, the least material, whatever it is, what gives me the greatest strength, that I suddenly found nature had done it over here also for the same reasons. But I had never copied the nature, ever. So this is, first place, is a complete misinterpretation of me. So we're not coming in. It is not what I'm talking. It does not operate the way I'm operating. What about your concept of eternal metabolics? I don't say eternal metabolics. External metabolics. Oh. Where does it come from? What do you think of Professor McLuhan's utilization of that idea in his works? There's something called extracorporeal artifacts. They're internal, and I have extracorporeal. So the tools I went into, I said many creatures are tool makers. The species exists by virtue of in separately operating organism parts. That the nest of the bird and the bird are absolutely one. that you cannot have the bird without the nest. And so I've then had extensions, mechanical extensions of my arm. Then I get something else that goes to make some scissors out of it, because it's sweeter a little more than I can shear a little more. So I've I can't find any tools that are not extensions, originally integral functions of the human being. And so I go back to Nine Chains to the Moon of 1938, and I talk about the mechanical extensions of man. First met Master McLuhan in Greece in 13 years ago, and we're going aboard a ship, and he somebody spoke to me, and he turned around and realized it was, so he called to me, and he had two of my books in his hand, and one was Nine Chains of the Moon, and he said this is my Bible, and if you ask Master about this, he'll tell you his extensions of man and so forth. Well, it came out of this. He got the electrical extensions of man, and then got into, this brought him into ways of talking about the communication system, whatever it may be. But Marshall said, Bucky, your expressions are old-fashioned, and I have a lingo. So when I talked about man backing up into his future, said, Bucky, that it's called rear mirrorism. So he gave me titles. Marshall will tell you this. He really said, and deliberately said, he was enlarging on my ideas. We're very, very good friends. And these things have been said out loud very much on the stage and platform together. So that I know what I'm not saying something as offensive. He says that he's an English scholar, literature scholar. And his memory, incidentally, is incredible of things he's read. And he began to feel that a great many people who he read many books that society didn't know about, and society was missing some very important things, so he started really taking things he'd read about that other people had written, and began to get society to know about it. But he gets so enthusiastic, he didn't necessarily always say, I'm extending this person's idea, his idea. He began to make it his own, so he began to develop it, which is very reasonable. But if you, he's a man of integrity, so if you check with him about that, he'll say, yes, that is correct. Then his enthusiasm carried away, and he forgot to give footnotes of where he got there. But external metabolics, I have metabolics, and these are energy processing, converting the very kind of way, with photosynthesis, whatever it may be, is always energy interexchangings and all to do with regenerations or work, doing work. So I have then the mechanics internal to the man, and his then using the principle external to himself, and then the energy is to operate the externals, so that the external metabolics would be what he uses in his machinery, in contradistinction to what the metabolics internally is, the food that he converts into growth and work. Is that good? Is that clear with that part? Dimaxion, where did that come from? Apply just to a specific set of artifact inventions. When the 1927, when I developed the Dimaxion house first, and I had a model, and we had this newborn baby, and my wife, and we were in a little flat up in northwest Chicago, and Some old friend came to see me in one way or another. Marshall Fields, one of the buyers at Marshall Fields in Chicago, heard about this and came up, and the head of the advertising department. In Paris, 1926, there was a great Paris exhibition of very modern things. This was the beginning of the world really knowing such names as Corbusier, and there were the Bauhaus, and many, many things were exhibited in that Paris exhibit in 26. The Chicago stores, buyers like Marshall Fields and never mind the other names, Casa Piri Scott, and so forth. These buyers went to the exhibit in Paris. They were trying to outdo the New York stores. Chicago, in those days, felt very competitive with New York and was continually trying to really show it was a more advanced culture. And they were going then to have their Chicago World's Fair of 33. And anyway, the buyers, Marshall Fields and these other stores, bought a great deal of the special fabrics and the special chairs and all the things of the well-known Bauhaus group. And they brought these things back to their store to sell. They bought quite a lot of stuff. And suddenly, Chicago decided it'd like to have its World Fair of 33. So they needed, these things had come from, that had been ordered in the Paris Fair, didn't get delivered until about 1928. Because they were things, whether it's Breuer making a chair, he only had one in the exhibit, and he had to make some more. So the people who got these orders had to find a way to produce them. So they did, and the things began to arrive in Chicago. The Chicago World's Fair was determined on by the community in that year, 1928, when these things began to arrive, 27. And they said, we're going to have Chicago architects go design this thing. We don't want any nonsense as European. The Carson Pierce Scott, Marshall Field, had bought architectural models of Corbusier's. So they were going to have the windows of these stores. We're going to have all these European Bauhaus things in the window so they could sell all the goods inside. And suddenly the really powerful people of Chicago, Marshall Field himself and so forth, agreed that Chicago World's Fair should be absolutely run by Chicagoans. They didn't want these European architects being celebrated like that. So that they squashed the whole thing. And the house furnishings and whatever department was that owned all this bric-a-brac and chairs and furniture were in quandary because they'd spent a lot of their money. I think they had well over a quarter million Master Fields they had in there. So somebody told them about my house. And they came up to see me, this model, and looked at it and said, I didn't know about this dilemma that I just told you until after, things were well underway. They asked me they said they were very excited by my model and they wanted to exhibit it in Marshall Fields. And Marshall Fields does a certain amount of cultural things. They do have some exhibits and once in a while they have some old Chinese urn or something like that. Anyway, they run my house to be on exhibit and they showed me the place where it would be and I felt that's all right. So, having decided they're going to show my model, they'd like to have me give some lectures on it. And so it was agreed that I would give these short lectures quite a few times a day. And so then they said they needed a name for this. They said there's a Bauhaus. What's the name of this thing? I said, it doesn't have any name. And well, we've got to have a name. So they had two men they called wordsmiths who often invented names for Marshall Field for things they're going to sell in the store. And they also helped other manufacturers give names to products. These men had a great reputation because they invented the word radio, which is quite a good invention. So they were in great demand, and one was named Warren, I can't remember the other man's name. Anyway, they asked me to lunch with them down. Marshall Field has a nice restaurant in there. Asked me down to Marshfield restaurant for lunch. And they asked me to start telling them and talking about why I'd produce this house and what was the philosophy of it and so forth. They asked me questions. So about 3 o'clock, it started lunch at noon, they stopped and then a couple of days later they called me up and asked if we'd meet again. And lunch again. So then they had sheets of paper. And one of them would say, what was it you said about this? And then the other one would say, what did you say about that? I didn't know what they're doing, but I would repeat as best I could. And What they did was to go home independently after the first meeting. I can tell you everything that went on because I told retrospectively. Each one went home, and they hadn't made any notes at the luncheon, but each one went home and wrote down what they thought were the most prominent things that in their memory that I had said, testing then their memory, what they remembered, sort of a sieve to pick up, bring out what was prominent. So each one had written down what they could remember. There were fragments of this, fragments of that. So that piece of paper had then what they remembered. So then they'd ask me what I said about this, what I said about that. And then they'd say, would you say that again, and so forth. And finally it turned out that they had then, by listening to me, they picked out then which was the most prominent word, which was the most prominent sentence in all the things I said, which of all the, if I've said a whole paragraph, which sentence they remember. So they'd write that out very quickly. This was highly impressionistic. Then they came back, found out which word in the sentence was the most prominent. Then they finally had me say, which is the most prominent syllable in that word? So they resolved everything I'd done down to a set of words and the most prominent syllables. They had really enormous list of them by this work, because they kept at this for a week or so with me. And finally, they took all the syllables, and I said, there are harmonic ways of bringing syllables together, and there are graphically acceptable ways, there are shocking ways, there's euphony, and there's graphology, harmony. So we're going to have to make words out of these syllables of yours. They said, we've counted, and you're a four-syllable man. So it has to be a four-syllable word. And so they then made up all the four-syllable words possible out of all the syllables, which were the pepper and salt of my speech. And then they had all these typewritten lists, and they said, we now have got to know you well enough to know you won't like any of them. So what we're going to ask you to do is like a tennis match. You can pair any two of them you want and throw out the least desirable. So you have to keep going through all this list, and finally the one word is left. And the word that was left, they said, was this word dimaxion. And they said, we're sure you don't like that, but you say it for a few days, you're really going to find that this is an abstract of you. It is a word portrait of you. And so I did try. They then get out engraved announcements for my exhibition, and Chicago really did show up. The fancy people in Chicago showed up, and it went on for 3 weeks, and I kept giving five lectures a day, whatever it was. It was quite a tiring one. And I met very interesting, like met Korzybski, came to see me at the model there, and asked me to go and listen to him speak down at Chicago University, and got me into semantics. Many, many things came out of it, but what I learned was then, they found my house was so far out that it made the Bauhaus things look very, very safe. And so they were selling all this stuff. They just sold everything right off under the edges of my being too far out. this is a strategy they often use to make things sell by making things sell, something much more extreme that the people wouldn't buy. So that's where I got dimaxion, and then Marshall Fields copyrighted it and made me a present of the name and said, this is yours. And it's interesting, I have used it, and it's been really very, very good. But that's how it happened. That's your end of yours, Jack. Nicholas Peckham. What was the technology of the pyramids? I've been to Egypt quite a few times, and I couldn't be more fascinated with the stonework that they've done, and particularly you get to Luxor and find those extraordinary needles. And there was one of Hatshepsut, Queen Hatshepsut, that These stones were apparently quarried and floated on Nile. But how they were able to pick them out hammering and so forth, I don't know, but there's one that was never erected, still there. It's been dressed out as the stone's been dressed out, lying on stones horizontally. But if you take, just take a knife out of your pocket, a key, something metal, you hit it, it's absolute bell. It's the most beautiful bell. This thing is 70, 80 feet long. But the purity of the stone, apparently, they tested so that it would be no flaws whatsoever. I can understand how they quarried, but I would not know how they picked that stone. They must have had their tricks, all right, for ways of sounding around in the mountain, doing whatever you do with hammers. But I can understand how they floated it there. That would be very easy. You can float. And I can see how you could handle that on rollers. I can see how it could be crowbarred along onto the boat. How to move things by levers and rollers doesn't seem to be anything very novel about that. Trees are inherently round, so even our bare island trees that we strip with bark on the beach immediately become superb rollers, and when you're pulling boats in and out, you can get hold of a roller awfully fast in nature. So I think that they had rollers all right. And then when it comes to the pyramids themselves, building these extraordinary, how they dressed to such accuracy, dressed the stone, that I don't know, but there's no question about the beautifulness of fit you get. But you find that not just in Egypt, I'll find it in Japan, around the world, you get old Greece, incredible fitting of stones. And where stones are dressed in really quite uneven ways, the Egyptians got at least into some pretty accurate symmetries, but there were so many stones in Greece, the very, very oldest stonework you'll find, an incredible way they fitted, it's been dressed to fit another stone, fitting absolutely superbly, with great irregularities of the stones. I'm certain that the building of the pyramids, with the sands drift up very rapidly, it's very easy to make breaks, as with snow breaks, and you make the sands drift. I'm quite certain that they simply drifted sand up more and more, the worker kept rolling up on the sand, that they made the ramps of sand. You can understand that? That would be, as far as I'm concerned, the great, that's what we're really getting at with the pyramids. I don't know why, it seemed absolutely obvious to me that this is one thing I would do if I had to do that job there, and I'm surprised I haven't read other people suggesting that. There probably are others, and probably somebody may know that, but what is shelter? The word comes from shieldrum or shell. The shieldrum was a shield in a war, and the shelter is big enough really over yourself. I think that I gave you Naga wise that people also use the boats upside down, but. I think it's very much just that same root as a shell or a tortoise or whatever it is, a protection. What economic system is an outcome of comprehensive anticipatory design science? I don't know of any. The economic systems are very much push and pull and selfishness and might. And absolutely no good faith, so you had to use gold because you wouldn't trust anything else. You know, everybody's a crook, so they have to get something that is apparently incorruptible. And then this heaviest metal seemed to do the thing that stayed shiny. One thing seemed to be found around the world that could carry on, so monetary wise, I don't know any economic system then. It seemed to be just give and take, and suddenly find you're hungry and you need some food. And somebody may control that food and maybe not. If they did, they made you pay a price. you might call the five-year planning of Russia. But I wouldn't call that an economic system. I would call that, to some extent, comprehensive anticipatory design science. It was for a whole economy. It wasn't for the whole world. It was for their special economy. It doesn't really quite come into, but it is nearer to it. What's the relationship between precession 90 degrees and the tetrahedron 60 degreeness? How did you get to know what you know? The tetrahedron one, remember when I pulled the tetrahedron out of the cube and we had a continuous string that went from one side to the other, and I pulled the tetrahedron through it, and as I pulled the tetrahedron up, the string kept opening up, the quadrangle got wider and wider and shorter, and finally got to be a square. Then I kept pulling the tetrahedron through it, the string was always absolutely rounded, and finally the string went the other way, precessed. But what you find is the tetrahedron is exactly the same distance all the way around, and it's always a rectilinear section. So one reason then, when they take the two halves of a tetrahedron and a solid one, a wood, you find a square central section. And you take the square section and turn it like this, and then they come together again. So that's where your 90 degreeness is in there, and the precessional effect is in that tetrahedron, of the one edge going to this, the other, as your 90. Okay? Then, how did you come to know what you know? Well, I was given a lot of equipment, which is the brain, to store the information and pull it back. Going on with our questions, the first one this afternoon, we are all aware of the documents documenting phase one of the design revolution. What is phase two? I think we call that the design decade rather than design revolution, those documents. I do talk about a design revolution versus a bloody revolution, but I don't think there are any documents of design revolution. Those documents of phase one, there were five phases of the design decade, and the first one was the statement of the problem. That was how to get people to realize the problem existed, and then it did go into the resources. I think that was all spelled out. There were 5 2-year phases, and they were all literally spelled out. The design decade came about when there's an international union of architects. They have congresses every 3 years, and now they spread it to 5 years apart because the expense is high. They hold in countries all around the world, and both sides of the communists and then the Western world. And at the London meeting in 1956, it's about that time that they asked me to speak, and I made a proposal of this design decade because they had an annual, every time they had a congress, a problem had been given out to students at architecture schools around the world, and winners in various countries of the competition would be sent to the International Union of Architects Congress. So there was a student exhibition of these competitions, and this was done really on the old Beaux-Arts basis of competition. Proposed, instead of competing one with the other, they were to do a cooperative study on how they might be solving world problems by design and developing the right artifacts and so forth. So this was a published by Architecture Design magazine, and then it got somebody put up the money for them to put it in all the different languages, and they sent it to all the different architecture societies that were members around the world. Princeton Magnus, who's architects, is a member of the International Union of Architects. They take the different countries, and it's the only society I know that actually involves all the ideologies around the world, really quite completely. The Chinese stand very thoroughly, and so forth. The different countries around the world then responded regarding the proposition that putting this design decade, which I proposed, that there would be cooperation for ten of their five different international union meetings. And I was amazed at the response from China and Russia were very favorable. I think Russians are rather slow. Chinese came in quite quick, approving it. Russians, I thought, might be some kind of a Western world trick, and they began looking, and then they approved it. The United States was the slowest to come in, but they finally did. And so it became really actually a world-round project, and we were given... It had great interference after Paris. We had Paris and then Prague. The Paris exhibition, we were given a very large section of the Tuileries Gardens for the exhibit of the students from... Very, very well done. And then, as a consequence of the Congress taking me on, the next one after France was to be in Mexico, to be in Cuba. And I received a letter from the Cuban architects saying that, as I knew, that my proposition had taken on, they were going to feature the student side of things at the Cuba Congress, and I was to be their guest of honor there in Cuba. So at that time, this was fairly early in the Kennedy administration, and the George Bundy, who had been at Harvard, dean at Harvard, and he'd been head of the Charles Elliott Norton Committee, and he's the one who notified me that I've been chosen to be Charles Elliott Norton Professor at Harvard. And so I went to George Bundy, because of being the Security Council, and said I was going to have to have a visa, I was going to have official permission to go to Cuba, which I couldn't do on my passport. And he said, you can't do it, we can't let you do it. And would I not try to? There were a number of American, the Central American and so forth, in their American Alliance business who would not be able to go to Cuba. And so they were going to have a holdover meeting in Mexico. I said that I had a world initiative, and I thought that's really a credit to our economy that I did, and I ought to be allowed to go. And I thought it could make a deal of trouble if it didn't. He said they just couldn't let me go because this is the Democrats. So the Republicans are always claiming that the Democrats are communists, and we can't make any move like this, but they're being anyway friendly, acquiesce on communism. And so I talked to Dean Acheson, who'd been the Secretary of State previously, and he was in the State Department. He said, the only thing you can do is to go to the Republicans. And if they, because this being apparently, Cuba was some kind of a battleground between the two of them, and so I did go, Henry Luce and others that I knew well, and they went out and they came back and said that they couldn't possibly do it because the Republicans were going to make the Cuba an issue in their next presidential campaign, and if they approved my going, they would lose all their momentum. Nobody would let me go. I had also been invited to China and something else, and I was not allowed to go there. To help on structures by the Chinese government through Canada. I never do things on. I use what I call front doors. I don't try to do any back doors. I don't try to be subversive. I just really try to get things to work, and this didn't work. And when I did go to the holdover meeting in Mexico City, and Sir Robert Matthew of England was the president of the International Union of Architects at that time, and my wife Anne and I were sitting there in this big hall in Mexico City when they opened there, and Sir Robert Matthew said that he reported to the Congress on the success of the Cuban meeting, but he said there was one very important flaw, and that was that I was not there, and that the South American students, the South American, Central American students had come there in really very great numbers because the Cubans were featuring it as a student's phase of emphasis for the World Congress. And they found that I wasn't there. So they said this proved that the United States citizen was not a free citizen at all. This really proved that this kind of democracy didn't work. It became a very big battle. They turned in an enormous hassle the whole Congress about this. And I think they made a very, very great mistake not letting me go. At any rate, this did upset the design decade quite a lot. And so I really, really couldn't carry on the way I wanted before. I'd had this initiative, and I was doing everything at my own office, doing everything at my own expense. There was no money given me from anybody. I took care of my own publications. John McHale did a lot of the writing for me, and did a very good job. Now, I think that's about all I can tell you about that. If you do look at the decades, documents, you will see that I did have in five phases, and they are in effect complete. That is all over, but it really did peter out. I'm sorry to say, it started very, very strong. Jeffrey Hoare. It has been stated that the universe can be completely described in terms of energy, associative, and information. It would seem that synergetic geometry provides a means to do this, all with angle and or frequency. Has there been an effort to explain all known generalized principles in terms of this form of mathematics? Also, do you feel that it has enabled you to discover any new generalized principles or restate known generalized principles in a significantly different way? I hope you will read my book, Synergetics, and I do find I've been amazed how much philosophy it has generated. I've been really quite astonished at how many times I've been able to understand social phenomena that I haven't understood before. Seems to be explained by the principles that are disclosed. There have been a number, really, of mathematical discoveries. I'm sure they go well over 100 that are in it, and there's really no way to get them except to read that book. I think that's about the only. I'd say I really do read the book. I hope you will. You sound as if you'd be interested in it, probably.